Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda and I'm joined today by one of the legends of motocross, Mike LaRocco. So,
how's
dude,
going?
Thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
Really excited to have you here. On the drive down here, I was thinking about like how long I've known you and thinking back to the early days of working with you as a journalist at Cycle News and stuff. So it's been a long time and it was a really good career for you in motocross, wasn't it?
Yeah, definitely seemed like a lifetime ago, but yeah, motocross has been good to me. I do remember, was it MX Racer?
Yeah, MX Racer magazine.
I don't remember Cycle News so much, but I remember MX Racer. It's been a long time.
Yeah, I think one of the coolest cover shots I ever did MX Racer was I flew out to Indiana and you had that jump where we made it look like you're jumping over your parents' house, right?
Right. Yeah, I just came across that the other day. Yeah. Well, it was unique in two ways. One, that I whipped it, and two, that we got to look like it was over the house. So that was way before all this crazy stuff now.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Cool. Before. All right, so let's do like the 50 Cent run through your career. I mean, you turned pro in, what, 92, around there?
No, I think I did my first race in 80, I want to say 87.
Okay.
Because I think they did, used to do Gainesville like in the middle of Supercross.
Yeah, that was really odd.
So I think it was Gainesville 87. I think I did a couple in 87.
And then on a Yamaha.
Yeah, on a Yamaha support. And then I did the full season in 88.
Okay.
So. I think it was with Yamaha in 87 and 88.
And Suzuki.
Actually in 89. And then I went to Suzuki in 90.
Yeah.
So.
I seem to remember there was like a lot of mechanical troubles when you're on Suzuki.
Well, the first round at Suzuki, not so much. Like I was also younger then and you just kind of rode what was ever handed to you, right? It was a lot easier. When you're young, it's a lot easier, at least it used to be. And then my second round at Suzuki, when they had a new bike in the 95, 96 area, that was tough on me.
Yeah.
That was tough on me because I came from Kawasaki where I was winning and then got there and just kind of had some issues and lost some confidence. And that was a big turn in my career.
Yeah. Okay, so the Kawasaki years were pretty fruitful for you. You had the 500 national championship in 93 and 250 in 94, I believe.
Right. I mean, it wasn't all fruitful. I won my first race at Suzuki in 1990. I don't know if I did anything in 91, but as I went into 92, or actually on Suzuki, we used to, because they didn't have a 500, so.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, so we used to drop down to the 125 class in 90-91. So I always seemed to do pretty good on the 125. So I ended up signing a deal with Kawasaki on a 125 ride when I was already riding 250s at that time. So anyway, I had a good 125 season going until the last few rounds of that 125 national where I had those mechanicals and ended up losing that title.
Mm-hmm.
And then that was 92, and then 93, the 500, 94, the 250. So it ended up good, but even at the end of 95, I think I had a wrist injury and a knee injury. So and it started off bad and ended bad, but the middle was good.
Yeah. All right. You know, the other day we went out with Jeremy McGrath, and he bought a KX 500 on Craigslist and rebuilt it. And it's funny how like now, old two-strokes are all the rage, right? And people just love 500s too, right? But I believe you're the last 500 national champion.
Yeah. I did see some, he's posting a lot on the 500. I actually really liked that thing. The Kawasaki was super easy to ride, really good, throttle control. And it was very nimble. It was a real fun bike to ride.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I would still say that because I haven't been one in a while, but that's what I remember.
What was a factory KX 500 like compared to say a production one? Because I've ridden a production one plenty of times and raced it. And
I got to be honest, I probably never rode a production one because I would have jumped right in on whatever the factory had. And I do remember when I went to Honda not several years later, I ended up riding us the production KX 500, and I was like, I'm not riding that again.
Yeah.
That thing was scary. So I don't know. It's either they, when I got it, it was tuned in and ready to go, or, you know, it was just a better bike. I don't know.
Yeah. Back then, during the 500 era, was it kind of like, oh man, I'm gonna ride a 500, those things are gnarly? Or was it just like another bike option back then? Because, like, you know how things get bigger and better and faster as time goes on in memory? Like, people just think about the 500s and how gnarly they were.
Yeah, I think, but remember, I came up looking up to those guys that were riding 500, so it was just something.
Couldn't wait to ride one.
It was something that, you know, that I just knew was, you know, it's like when you look at the, I mean, at the time, the 250 class was a premier class, so if the 250 was split with 500, I mean, oh well, it's still the premier. So I remember, actually remember riding with Jeff Stanton kind of coming up, and at that time he was on the YZ490, and we switched bikes one day, and that thing was kind of scary. So, I mean, when you kind of put things in perspective, if I look back, I think, yeah, but I mean, my mind frame at that point was, I wanted to be on it. I mean, I was kind of, things were going well for me at that time. So it just felt, I felt like it was really good for me.
Mm-hmm. Did it take a big adjustment in your riding style when you switched from the 250 Nationals to 500? And did you have to train differently or anything?
No, I think that's the thing. Like the thing was so powerful. And then like on a 250, I always tried to ride a gear high, and you're always trying to find make a 250 pull the higher gear. And it was always like, you're always borderline trying to get enough coming out of the corners. And when I got on the 500, it did. And at that time, it still had the older steel chassis where it was, you know, developed enough to where it actually was very nimble. You could ride insides. And I don't think I ever went probably under second gear on that thing, or it could just pulled really well. So the adjustment kind of fit my riding style, because I did like to lug it. I wasn't a revver. So I don't remember, I remember at that point in my career, like starting to lift weights and knowing that the stronger as I got stronger, the easier everything was, but I don't know that I did it for 500. It was just something I was doing.
Yeah. How gnarly was the roost in those Nationals back in the day?
The 500 roost
sucked. I mean, it's crazy to think, like, even before you, like, Wardy would race with an open face.
Yeah, it's crazy. I don't know. I don't know, but I know every week I came home with just bruises. You know, like everywhere there wasn't something, I had bruises. It was gnarly.
Yeah. During that time, your teammate Mike Kudrowski in the same truck, you guys had a pretty gnarly like rivalry inside the same team, right?
Yeah.
What caused that? Was it just two guys battling for the top spot, or did your personalities clash?
I think I don't know so much personality wise, but if you remember at that time, I was pretty aggressive. And so he was winning, in 93, won the 250 title. And then in 93, I won the 500. But in 92, we were offset. He was on 250 already. So he was winning, and I, you know, like, when you're competitive, like, no matter, he's on the same color, like, I have to beat that guy. And so I, you know, it just was one of those things. I think I annoyed a lot of people because I did a lot of bumping running, and nobody likes to be disrespected. And I think it's just got to that point where we were fighting for the same, like, if we were on different teams, I'm sure it would happen too, but it was certainly awkward when we had to go upstairs and stare at each other afterwards. But I don't know how to explain it. It was probably just the fact that he felt disrespected by the way I was riding. And I honestly look at it like the stuff that we had issues with were, like, we both wanted to win.
Yeah.
And so I would probably expect the same out of everybody. I mean, I might whine about it, but for sure I'm expecting the same. So it just happens when you're competitive.
Yeah. Well, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. We're going to hear more about this rivalry when we come back.
Mm-hmm.
Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm joined today by Mike LaRocco. And when we left off, we were talking about the rivalry between you and Mike Kudrowski. What race was that where he ghost rode his bike into you after the finish line?
That was Red Bud.
That was your home race,
yeah.
And he did that to you then.
And it was first moto, I think. Yeah, it was first moto. So I think I was hounding him the whole race. And then, we were really similar speeds at that time. So I remember, Red Bud's track. There was, I forget what they called it, but it's after the Monza Wall. Then they had a little horseshoe that mm-hmm. came in there. And there, it was the slowest part on the track. And there wasn't much track left after that. You had the, I don't know if they had whoops back then, but mm-hmm. there wasn't much track left. And I knew just from, kind of stalking and pacing, like where my chances were. So I took, there was a tight U-turn, and I know I came in and I hit him right behind the foot pegs, and it kind of pushed him forward, and he went over the rut and cross-roaded and fell. And then, came in right after me, still got second. But so I won the first moto, and as I'm pulling off to go to the podium, he hits me with his bike, right? And
yeah.
I looked back and I thought, what did he do?
Make you fall?
No.
He goes for his bike.
Yeah, and he falls forward and his bike hits me. I mean, his bike hit me, but I for some reason I didn't fall over. But and for the first I was like, what did he do? Like, what a dork, But afterwards I realized what
he
did.
And,
yeah. And so that was awkward because we went back to the truck afterwards, and at the time Roy Turner was a team manager, and of course everybody followed us over there. So he shuts the doors on the semi, and he's inside, and he's like, look, I don't even remember what he said exactly, but I know something about being competitive, but this is not who we want to be, and if you guys can't cooperate, nobody's racing the second moto. So it's funny now, but I couldn't imagine as a team manager having to deal with that.
Yeah, right.
But we ended up going back out there, and then I think I pulled a dumb move. I was winning the second moto, and then I think I fell once or twice, and I ended up giving him the overall. But it was just one of those things. I think that was probably, I don't think I ever won Red Bud, and that was the one I gave away. But I gave a few away. But anyway, that was an awkward time. But I don't think it was much longer. I think it went Red Bud, Unadilla. He might have broke his finger, and then that was kind of it.
Yeah.
So
yeah, and then
it escalated and ended.
It's funny because even after that, when he broke his finger because a rock hit him, right?
Yeah.
The MSR came out with a right. glove ad with a big gel pad, and it was all because of broken rock in your season or something.
Yeah.
Wow, even your sponsors are talking smack for you. Did it ever get so gnarly that you just wanted to kick his ass?
I don't know if you know this, but I'm not overly friendly appearing. But it was just kind of one of those things, you just go on your corner and you deal with it. I was a business. I didn't really let anything bother me, and we weren't we didn't taunt or do anything. It was just when the helmet went on, it was all right, it's time. So, and again, it was that was in 94.
Mm-hmm.
Again, that season, he got hurt right after that. So it kind of
chilled out.
Yeah, and then I think I was hurt several times in 95. So we never really got to that escalation again.
Okay, at this point in your life, have you guys ever become friends or talk about that later?
Surprisingly, we ended up together. I think I was still racing at the time, and he might have been doing work stuff, but we ended up at a O'Neill photo shoot together.
Mm-hmm.
And even then, I wasn't really adult enough to kind of realize who we were in our careers, but it was awkward. But of course, it was, professional enough to where it was fine.
Wait. Is this the one that I shot?
Where
in
we were
Verona? In the studio.
I feel
in
like we were up by Chatsworth somewhere.
Okay, well, there was one that I shot for O'Neill, and it was six, seven athletes, as you, Kudrowski, Roncada. But
it might have been, yeah.
I had you and Kudrowski stand next to each other.
On purpose?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, see, that my little sense of humor then might have...
Yeah, 30. But no, at that time, I think I was still racing, but he was racing.
Yeah, off-road, so yeah.
It was fine.
Nice.
And it was always kind of fun. It was just, like I said, when you put the helmet on, it's just different.
Yeah. All right, the other rivalry I can remember is on the drive down here, Dahmer and I were talking about it. And he goes, remember when LaRocco and Emig used to go at it? And then that one time Emig kicked him in the back.
Yeah.
Was that another big rivalry for you?
It just, that one seemed to last for sure the longest, you know, and it was destined because Jeff always got good starts. And then I think most of the time I would end up catching him at some point in the race, and he would always cross jump and do whatever he could to keep you behind, which at the time I felt disrespected and I just wanted to crush him. But I get it now. He was, you know, he's trying to do what he can to stay up front. But as a racer, I was like, every time he cross jumped me, I felt like it was either we're both going down or he's going down. Like somebody's going down because I don't like it.
Yeah.
And then the San Diego thing was different. There was one section on that track where it was a gnarly ruddy or something, but I remember there was a step up where most guys weren't stepping all the way up, and they would step up one level and then do the thing, and then it was a right-hand turn. Well, somehow I was getting up on top and then coming down. Well, it was way faster, so I was making a lot of passes and time on everybody there. Well, I got a bad start, so I was in a hurry to get to the front. And so I stepped up on that one with Emick, and then he didn't know what was coming, so he turned under me, and I ended up landing on him, and we both went down. And that wasn't so much as the on-purpose one, like every other thing we did. I mean, there were several races where, you know, the silly stuff happened, but that one in particular wasn't. And I was just sending it, and I landed on him, and I was stuck under my bike, so he kicked me. But that was funny.
Do you think I think back to like the 80s and 90s, and there was like so much, like so many rivalries like that and fighting and stuff. Like, have riders gotten soft, or have the promoters gotten too strict and on that kind of stuff right now?
My take on it is, it's like, you've watched a pit bike race, right? Mm. And it's that stuff happens, right? And I think with our sport now, it's just too fast. So you can't come in and just kind of bump into somebody at 50 miles an hour. You could do it at 20 miles an hour or 30 miles an hour, and the risk is whatever the risk is. But I think, you know, as the speeds got higher in our sport, like that kind of stuff, it's too risky. So, you know, you have to be a little more patient, and it just isn't as, you know, aggressive as it used to be, because you have to be smarter.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Hey, we're going to take another quick break to hear from our sponsors, but we'll be back for more with Iron Mike.
I've been with FXR for, you know, going on 4 years now. It's a small company starting out. It's growing really quickly, so it's nice to be a part of those guys.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one. Be unstoppable.
One goal, one vision.
We have four colors right now. Retails for $28.95 at odigrips.com and, of course, your favorite retailer.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet, designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm joined by Mike LaRocco today. And so where we left off is we were talking about, you know, the rivalry between you and Evig and the way the sport is a little bit different now. I don't want to leapfrog past a whole bunch of years, but when you went to start the factory connection team, essentially, with Ziggy, that was still on two strokes back then. But you evolved into four strokes with that team. But what was the big change that you saw happening with the technology?
Well, the way I can best remember it is when you were, let's say, Supercross on a 250 two-stroke, you do track walk and you kind of know your limitations and what your the bike's capable of. And I remember that, you know, this was at the end of my career, but I remember walking the track as a two-stroke rider going, man, I think we can do that, but it's going to take everything I have. And then the next year riding a four-stroke going, man, I know I can do that, but I don't want to. I mean, the power difference and, you know, the lack of bog, you know, yeah. The things that always kept you on your toes on the two-stroke all went away, and they gave you more power. So it was just tough because the capabilities were up immediately, mm-hmm. you know, and I rode the two-stroke out probably a year, maybe a year longer than most, just because I just, you know, I was old and I was just not really ready to change, but I felt like I was at a disadvantage. So the last year I switched, but that's it. I feel like the power delivery in the traction and the anti-bog was, it allowed us to do so much more that it changed really the perspective on, like I said, walking the track for one, but also two, you know, you could just do so much more. I mean, I do remember the one struggle was stopping it. Like it that was a hard thing to get used to, but, you know, and so was the power, but it changed kind of immediately when I went from two stroke to four stroke.
Mm-hmm. What year was it that you started with, the factory connection team?
So we got together at the end of 97. So
97.
It was post second round at Suzuki. And, you know, Ziggy and I started at the end of 97 and then went racing in 98 first year.
So at that point, after the bad luck years, your second stint at Suzuki, was it kind of like rebuilding your career from then or like?
Well, it was, and you know, a lot of things at that time changed because I didn't really probably understand and respect my position being able to ride motorcycles for a living, and what I saw when I was at Suzuki was I was winning before that and now I'm not, and it kind of sucked. So yeah. I didn't do the best PR in 96 and 97 with Suzuki, you know, I blew that for sure, but I had learned a lot, and when I started with Ziggy in 98, I was more of an adult. I really didn't want to be done racing. I was coming off some bad years, so I didn't have a lot of a... It for sure was a rebuilding year, but it was also... I learned a ton from being in that position, and then I just wanted to be better. I started respecting the fact that you get to ride motorcycles for a living and all that stuff. So I would for sure tell you it was a rebuilding year, but mm-hmm. more on top of that, it wasn't necessarily that I didn't go and get great results right away, but it was like all that other stuff was changing, and then understanding sponsorship and all that stuff, just a big, more of an adult transition.
Mm-hmm. I remember you on Suzuki, the second stint, you were in that really crazy, gaudy looking MSR gear. And then when you switched to the Factory Connection Honda, that was when you jumped on board with O'Neill.
Yeah.
And I'm very fortunate to be good friends with Frank Kashar at O'Neill, and he credits you with the big current day resurgence of O'Neill.
And if I remember right, he was kind of getting involved with O'Neill, not like around that same time too. So yeah, it was great for both of us. That was MSR at that time, I think, switched, and they went like with Albertine or something at the time.
Yeah.
And again, it just worked really well with me kind of starting over and just, I don't know, redefining who I was, and mm-hmm. it just kind of fit with O'Neill. It was a good fit for both of us.
You were in a lot of ads, I remember.
Yeah.
The O'Neill ads.
It's good.
Jack in the Box. Mm-hmm. That first year. It seemed like that team always had some cool sponsors. There was Jack in the Box, and then you had Doc Martens at one point, right?
Yeah. It's just the sport is, it's tough corporate, because there's so many rules, with corporate. And then when you kind of get that, it's not often that you can find I was in a position in my career where I didn't have a great factory ride option. I had mm-hmm. already been through everybody. And so it's not often that you can find a guy with a name and have the flexibility of a private team. So mm-hmm. that kind of worked for us. So it started off small. We did have Jack in the Box and Doc Martin, but there was just some great people that aligned with our team and, just had clever minds. And at that time there isn't a whole lot of things you can do. So you had to get creative. And then mm-hmm. I luckily got hooked up with some people that were creative.
I remember at the time I was thinking, it's kind of weird that LaRocco was sponsored by Jack in the Box, because you were a renowned fanatical like trainer, and I remember reading stories in another magazine about how you weighed all your food that day and everything. Did you ever eat a Jumbo Jack?
I don't know about a Jumbo Jack, but I did do the teriyaki chicken bowl.
Oh, you did?
Frequently, yeah. and it was, you have to understand that there's those days where, like, I will tell you, if you met me from, say, preseason from November to the first race in January, like, none of that stuff happened. But I mean, I do remember, that I would, if I got podium or a win or whatever, I would reward
treat
myself
yourself
with junk food. So it wasn't like I was totally crazy, but mostly.
So when you guys were sponsored by Doc Martens, did you get as many boots as you wanted?
Yeah, got plenty of boots.
You still have any of them?
Yeah, probably somewhere. But
nice. So from racing, in your stint as a racer with the team, I think you're a world supercross champion, and then you won the U.S. Open, right?
Mm.
So, I mean, man, right towards the end of your career, some pretty big titles.
Yeah, I mean, it's all, they're titles, yes. But I mean, at the time, when you want to be the regular supercross champion and you don't, that's the bummer part, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, of course, I can look back and I wish I did better, but I mean, you take what you have. And I mean, all I can say is I wish I did better, but I mean, for the most part, I did enjoy the whole run, and I respect having been able to ride a motorcycle for a living.
Yeah, but I mean, what you did accomplish in your career is better than what 95% of professional racers do.
Yeah, it's just, unfortunately, when you get older and wiser, you know what you should have done different, and that's where I'm at right now. So
okay, so being older, wiser, Mike LaRocco, what did you leave on the table then? Did you not practice starts enough?
No, it's more about the belief, believe in yourself, and the building confidence, and like you know, when I became a team manager and I had the view from the tower and I could see, the guys that I was managing all ride very well and very capable of winning, but have doubt, like, mm-hmm. I go, man, I was that guy. Like, how do I help them? And so I had everybody telling me, like, you got this, you can do this. And until you believe, yourself, it's like, it's tough. So, I mean, I can reflect back on the years that I won championships and know for sure that my starts were better because I knew that I belonged and mm-hmm. I needed to win. But when you, it's tough in our sport when you, I could even come into the seasons and win the first couple rounds because I did my preseason training, and then all of a sudden a couple things go bad, and then next thing you know, you're doubting yourself. And it's just crazy stuff like that, that it's, it's unfortunate that I learned that too late. Mm-hmm. Those are the things that bug me.
Yeah. So earlier when I said didn't practice starts enough, I mean, you're a notoriously slow starter, but looking back now, was it a lack of confidence on the line or more so than bad reactions or something?
I'm a little pissed off that the lockdown thing came out so late. I was always a wheelie guy, uh-huh. and I didn't really ever figure out the technique for that. Even, I think it was well into when I was riding on Hondas at the end there before I realized to hold your legs under your in front of your foot pegs, mm-hmm. like silly stuff like that. But I do feel like the fork lockdown thing changed the world for starts.
Yeah.
And I do remember once that happened, I was good off the gate, but for some reason, I don't know if it was my weight or whatever, but I always lost somewhere around third gear. Mm-hmm. If it was a second gear start, I got a good start. If it was a third gear, and then there's too many times with a bad first turn crash that when you're older, you kind of do a little bit of that too much. But certainly the years that I was confident, I for sure know I got better starts.
Yeah. All right, you alluded to your time as a team manager. So after you retired from racing, it was about a 10-year run as a team manager of the GEICO Honda team?
Yeah, not quite seven, I think.
Seven?
It was, yeah.
Okay, but was it an easy transition for you to go into that role? Or was it a big learning curve?
Well, for sure a big learning curve because previous to that, I was a spoiled factory rider. And then when I actually got to the team side of it, I realized how much work goes into getting, your bike to that race and mm-hmm. everything leading up to it. I mean, we show up as a factory rider, ride, they have stuff ready, and then you go home, and you don't really realize how much work goes into it. So when I first got there, I for sure overshot, siding on the rider side of it, over the team side of it, because mm-hmm. I just didn't realize how much work went into it. And once I started to realize that, it definitely, of course it made sense, but I also respected, everybody that's on the team mm-hmm. way more than I did as a rider.
During your time as a team manager of GEICO Honda, which rider do you remember the most as being the most amazing guy to work with?
Amazing. Well, there's guys that I connected with, like Will Hahn and, even Malcolm Stewart, like guys that you could kind of lift up and get them mm-hmm. to get things done. But I do remember, I remember respecting Justin Barsha for, like, no matter what was going on, whether he had a bad practice or a bad heat race or a bad whatever, like he could just kind of shut everything off and get the whole shot and put himself out there and try to get things done. And most of the time, when he was early in his career, he got it done. And that was kind of cool because, you could just get him to get out there and he could drop all the shenanigans and get it done. So I did respect that. And I kind of admired that confidence because if you could easily weigh yourself down and not let that happen.
Yeah. It's kind of like if you could bottle that confidence and put it in other riders.
Right.
And be the missing ingredient in some titles. Definitely.
For sure.
All right. So I know after that run as team manager, I'm assuming you took a little bit of time to just enjoy life being retired or whatnot. But mm-hmm. you've got a new, exciting new chapter that you're working on right now.
Yeah. I've built a, it's an online, it's a, well, I built a website. And what I was trying to do was, I was talking to somebody's father that that just kind of noticed me, and he was just starts drilling me on questions, like, well, should I do this, should I do that, And that hadn't kind of happened. It happened, you know, pretty often. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, and I kind of just one day was reflecting back on, I mean, as you know, like these guys are trying to give their kids good direction, right? So long story short, I ended up deciding that, you know, would it not be good for somebody to have access to, you know,
to your those experience. Kind
of, yeah, experience, yeah. Because I've had, you know, the racing side. I mean, I did the amateur thing, I did the pro thing, and now I've done the team manager. And there's not a whole lot of people that have every one of those perspectives. And I feel like when you're, you know, when you're doing nothing and you feel like all your value is there and being wasted, like what do you do with it? Because I don't have that value to anywhere else in life, right? So anyway, I decided that I wanted to build a website based on what did I wish I used to know. And then, because you know, the guys that are successful, they have, you know, former pros to work with, or they got agencies, and they have everything available to them, but there's everybody else that doesn't have that, you know? So I'm trying to kind of provide that for all those guys that want it, that don't have that kind of access. So I built a website, and it's based around training. For the most part, I partnered up with a guy who has a strength and conditioning. He's a master's in strength conditioning. And I wanted to be able to kind of bring just whatever I can. So when we built the website, I built a training program with him. And, you know, in each of the blocks that we do, we explain why, you know, like if you want to learn it, you explain why. If you don't want to learn, it's right here in the, and it's all online stuff. But in each of those, I kind of do an article or two in those blocks saying stuff that I wish I would have known. And so I didn't know how else to offer it. So it's a monthly program where you can sign up, you get your training, you get your riding schedule. I mean, it, and each block is, it's kind of a periodized training program. So, but it's advice as much as anything, and as much as you want to learn, like there's, it's all in there on why. And I mean, I just feel like our sport's kind of confusing. Like, is it an endurance sport? Is it a strength sport? Like, so I try to take what I've learned over the years. And one thing I know is that the stronger I got, the easier everything was. But there was a point in my career when I was trying to get stronger, and then at the end of my career, I was trying to get lighter, because, you know, like, so there's a, I went to, you know, sort of a professional to find, like, let's find that balance, because I know strength is important, but I also know you don't want bulk, you know, so we built the program, and I'm just putting it out there.
Cool. So is the website all, it has to do with conditioning and training? Is any of it technique based?
So I, there's a, on one side you have the training program for the gym, and then the other side you have riding. So, you know, when I talk about the riding stuff, it's you know, so I'll recommend a practice schedule. And then, you know, like there's gonna be stuff in it to where, you know, where you try to learn to ride with faster people. Like, I don't know everybody's environment, so I kind of, like in each of the things, I have a riding schedule, and then in my take column, it's like why and what you should do at this track. And I just try to share as much as I can and what I've learned over the years.
Cool. All right, so for guys who are in Southern California, like you, I mean, is there an opportunity for them to work directly with you?
Yeah, I mean, there is that. I mean, right now, you can look on the website and you'll find there's a program one and a program two, which are the sort of the mobile where I expect everybody to sort of be afar, but or they have enough of their own thing going where they're just good with the little, it's like a foundation. But yeah, there's an info email on the website if you want more than that. I think there's some stuff in there that was riding technique stuff and personalized training stuff. And there's a program three where you can have full access. So there's options if you don't see what you like on any of the programs, just info, and I'll work for whatever.
Yeah, I remember through the years, you know, I've worked with you many times on like how-to articles, like how to do this or how to, you know, corner better or thing. And you're always one of the riders that was able to break down the riding technique nicely. Like there's some guys that are super talented, but they can't explain what they're doing because it comes so naturally. But I would imagine this is a great resource for people because of your ability to break down the riding process and explain what works and what doesn't?
It's tough, and it's going to be for sure tough online, but the stuff that's important, of course, is going to be spending a lot of time on your bike, but also just trying to take a perspective on what others are doing and why it works and stuff like that. But to break down the techniques, like I'm not so much of a picky guy on like a technique, like because mm-hmm. You'll see a lot of guys come to the pro level and they all got different styles, so you can't say one works and one doesn't. Mm-hmm. But what you can do is kind of define what isn't working for somebody and try to get him to pay attention to it. Because I know what worked for me was always, if I was a second off, and somebody could tell me one place on that track that was the most obvious, mm-hmm. like every lap I would come around there going, okay, I got to fix something. So I try something different every lap. It's just kind of getting in tune with how to make improvements, and I try to share that. It's tough without being trackside, but so the things that we are doing is just trying to make everybody aware on things that just have learned over the years.
Cool. All right. Well, you didn't tell me the name of the website.
Oh yeah. So the training program is five, and then it's based on I kind of broke it down where things that were important in racing, which one was focus, intensity, and I used volition, which is not accepting anything less, choosing a path and sticking mm-hmm. to it, and then experience. So it's at _5moto for Instagram, and you can link to the website from there. It's 5moto.com.
Cool. Well, hey, super pumped to have you on the show, buddy.
Appreciate
and,
it.
And I hope that this 5moto works out great for you. So if you're watching, check it out. And dude, thanks for coming on.
Thanks, man.
It's always been a pleasure working with you.
Likewise.
And so, like and share this video, and see you next time.